Let's go ahead this morning as we begin worship. Let's stand together.
I will worship you for who you are. I will worship you. Thank you. tell the world of treasure you've found. Be seated. This is time.
This morning, as we get started with our message, we're going to be in chapter 5 of the book of Acts. So if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and turn there. Hold that passage. And before we do, I want to look at just a couple of verses first in Matthew chapter 16. Now, Matthew chapter 16, we find a familiar passage. Jesus has just asked the disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And from that scene comes the confession of Peter that we all know, that we repeat when a new believer is baptized into Christ. Where Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Messiah, or the Son of God." And so I want to start this morning with the words that Jesus says following that encounter with Peter in Matthew chapter 16. This is verses 17 through 18. It says, "Jesus replied, 'Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven.'" Verse 18, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades," or the gates of hell, "will not overcome it." That's the promise that Jesus makes about his church. And this is before the church has come. This is before the Spirit has come upon the believers on the day of Pentecost in the book of Acts. And Jesus predicts that the church will be born through the confession of Christ of Peter and the apostles. And what does he say about the church of Jesus Christ? "Even the gates of hell will not be able to stop it." Even the evil powers in this world, the power of Satan himself, will not be a match for the church of Jesus Christ. And so today we continue a series that we started last week that we're calling Unstoppable. If there's one word that we'll use to describe the early church in the book of Acts, that's it. We're calling the church the Unstoppable Movement of God. So far in the book of Acts, here's where the unstoppable movement of God has gone. We looked at some of this last week. Jesus promises when he ascends into heaven that the church will be born through the Spirit coming upon them. He promises they'll receive the Spirit. He promises they will be witnesses eventually to all parts of the earth. And then that promise of the Spirit is fulfilled in chapter 2 when the believers are all meeting together on the day of Pentecost. The Spirit fills the room, the Spirit fills the apostles, and they speak in other tongues. And it says in chapter 2, verse 47, or 41 rather, 3,000 were added in one day to the number of the church. Chapter 2, verse 47 then says, "The Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved." In chapter 3, the work of the Holy Spirit continues in the church when Peter and John heal a man who had been begging at the temple gate called Beautiful at the Jerusalem temple, a man who 40 years, all of his life, had been lame. And this man goes walking and leaping and praising God in the temple courts. We looked at that story last week, and in that moment, Peter uses it as an opportunity to preach again, and it says in chapter 4, the number of believers then grew to about 5,000 men, which would not have included women and children. So we're talking about an act that has gone in just a short period of time, a movement of God that has gone in a short period of time from 120 believers to 3,000 believers to roughly 5,000 believers, and it's going to keep growing through the book of Acts. And so today we'll focus on chapter 5 as we continue to chart the growth of this unstoppable movement of God. But as we do, I want to start with a question. And it's as applicable today as we discuss the Church of Jesus Christ, this unstoppable move that continues today, as it was in the first century. Here's the question we'll start with today. It also starts your notes on the back of your bulletin. Could the work of God, the unstoppable movement of the church, be stopped by the sin of someone within the church? Could the unstoppable movement of God, could the work of the church be stopped by someone, by the sin of someone within the church? If the answer to that is yes, then either way, it has great implications on you and me today. And so we're going to answer that question by looking at a story in Acts chapter 5 today. In fact, we're going to answer that question by looking at three different sections of the fifth chapter of Acts today. So if you've got your Bibles, that is where we will be. Let's take a look then at Acts chapter 5. We'll start this time with verses 1 through 11. This is the story of Ananias and Sapphira. Acts chapter 5. Now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have lied not just to human beings, this version says, or to man, but to God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who heard what had happened. Then some young men came forward and wrapped up his body and carried him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter asked her, tell me, is this the price that you and Ananias got for the land? Yes, she said, that is the price. Peter said to her, how could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? Listen, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also. At that moment, she fell down at his feet and died. Then the young men came in and, finding her dead, carried her out and buried her beside her husband. Listen to how verse 11 ends this passage. Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events. You see, the question we're going to ask today, and it makes sense in the context of the passage we just read, this book of Acts, movement of the church, unstoppable move of God, can it be stopped? Can it be halted by sin within the body of the church? You see, Peter makes it clear here as he confronts Ananias and Sapphira what the immediate sin is that causes their striking down by God. Right? We concede the fact that throughout Scripture, immediate death, someone just dropping dead, is not God's general way of handling sin. Right? Praise the Lord for that, right? We understand that these are cases that are few and far between where this kind of thing happens. And Peter makes it clear that the immediate sin that causes this boom, drop dead, the men carry you out kind of punishment is the lying to the Holy Spirit. Okay? This is an act of the Holy Spirit, not just their deaths. The book of Acts and the work of the church. This is an act of the Holy Spirit. And so this deception they have perpetrated is a lie against the Holy Spirit. Peter makes it clear when he says to Sapphira, what would cause you to conspire against the Holy Spirit? You have deceived not just men, but God. So that's the sin that causes their death. This morning I want to ask another question about this scene. What is the sin behind the sin? In other words, what would bring a person, or in this case, persons, husband and wife, to try and lie to the Holy Spirit. It is a punishment that does not happen very often in Scripture because it is a sin that most people don't get to the point that they would try and deceive not just their fellow human beings, but also the Holy Spirit of God. And so the question this morning is, what is the sin that is underlying? What kind of underlying sin is causing this to happen? There are many sins that you and I would call underlying sins. These are the kinds of sins that lie within our hearts that would lead us to cause the sins that we commit. Let me give you an example. The sin of greed is a heart sin. Okay? It is an underlying sin that would be in my heart that might cause me to steal or to covet. Okay? The sin of lust, for example, is not a sin that you can look at a person and see, but the sin of lust is a heart sin that will later down the road cause someone to commit the sins of adultery or sexual immorality. You see, the sin of anger. In your anger, do not sin. When anger leads to sin, that's a condition of the heart sin that can cause a lot of other sins down the road. And so the question is, what kind of underlying sin could lead a husband and a wife who claim to be a part of the early church in the city of Jerusalem to lie not only to Peter, not only to the church, but to the Spirit of God? I think we'll understand a little bit more about the specific case of Ananias and Sapphira if we understand first what's going on in the church at that time. Take a look at Acts chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. This is the passage just previous to the one we just read. This happens right before the deaths of Ananias and Sapphira. Verse 32, chapter 4. All the believers were in one heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything that they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and God's grace was so powerfully at work among them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. What is the underlying sin that would cause the sin of lying to the Spirit in the case of Ananias and Sapphira? Now, you and I might study this passage and come up with a few different answers of that underlying sin. Here's what we're going to go with today, and we'll explain it as we go on. I believe, and I'm going to show that the underlying sin here is the sin of selfishness. That's what's the next line in your bulletin. What's the underlying sin? Today we're going to look at the underlying sin of selfishness. Look again at how Luke, as he writes the book of Acts, describes the sin of Ananias and Sapphira in chapter 5, 2 through 4. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but he brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, "Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land?" Verse 4 says, "Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? After it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have lied not just to man, but to God." You see, the true deception of this act seems to be that Ananias and Sapphira decided to keep a part of a piece of the money back for themselves while pretending to do what? while pretending to selflessly give it all. Now, based on what we just read in chapter 4, why would they pretend? Peter says, by the way, you're under no obligation to give everything. You're under no obligation to sell your property. Your property is at your own disposal to do with what you wish. And so, question is, why would they pretend then to selflessly give 100% proceeds of this piece of property to the church? What does chapter 4 end with? Chapter 4 ends with the example of Barnabas and others, people who in the church were doing that very thing. People who within the church, and it says, because the Spirit of God was so active among them, everyone was filled with the grace of God to the point that they continued to share what they had. People were selling barns and houses and properties and fields, and nobody was in need because everybody was coming together as the body of Christ. And then there's this guy named Barnabas who sells a piece of property, who lays it at the apostles' feet. And Luke doesn't say this, but most likely, he probably got a lot of praise and a lot of admiration among the people of the church. And here's Ananias and Sapphira who think, what's a way that we can get the same reaction from the body of believers? What's a way that we can increase our importance among this group of believers and yet still hold back some of the money just in case we need it down the road? You see, I believe that it's selfishness that is at work here in this sin. Peter asked Ananias, didn't it belong to you before it was sold? Wasn't the money at your disposal? There's no reason why Ananias and Sapphira couldn't have sold the piece of property and give half of the proceeds to the church, and the church been fine with that if they were honest with it. There was no early church mandate that said that they must sell their property and give all the proceeds to the church. But in order to keep up with the rest of those like Barnabas who were doing this very thing, they conceived this deception. And in doing so, they committed an act of deception not only against the church, but against the Holy Spirit of God. For this unstoppable movement of God is of the Holy Spirit. I wish I could say, church, that today the same kinds of acts of selfishness aren't going on in our world. But the truth is, our world, as I see it, is as self-interested and as self-centered as it ever has been. Look at 5 minutes of TV commercials. Look at 5 minutes of ads, and you'll see everything in our society is pointed at me. Everything in our society is about me. Think about the reports and the lawsuits and things that you see where people are just fueled by this desire to get mine, to get what is owed me. Look at the lawsuit commercials that are on TV that say, you know, basically anything you've ever done at any point under any circumstance you could probably sue someone for it if it didn't go well. Why? Why would we have that kind of mentality? Why would our society have that kind of a drive? Because the drive is all about self. Our culture is driven towards selfishness in a way that it is worse than it ever has been. And the reason is clear. As the consequences of sin grow, so grows the space between man and God. And as we fall farther and further away from God as a culture, as a society, then obviously we're leaning further and further in toward what is best for me. See, we're going to say today that the underlying sin here is the sin of selfishness. And I want to give you two truths about selfishness today as we go on. These are the next two truths in your notes as well. Number one, selfishness is sin. Okay? It's easy to see here. That's what we're talking about this morning. Selfishness is a sin that separates us from God. Romans 2 and verse 8 says, "But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger." In Galatians 5, 19 through 21, Paul is listing a list of sins that will not inherit the kingdom of God. Listen to what he says. "The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft." These are obvious, right? We're all looking and saying, "Oh, of course those are sins." "Hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition." Then he goes on. "Dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like." And he says, "I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God." Don't just look at the scriptures that talk about selfishness being a sin. Think about the words of Jesus. We don't have to look at them today. But think about, you know the words of Jesus. You know that whether or not he says selfishness is sin, the act of selfishness goes against what Jesus teaches. When Jesus says, if anyone would be the greatest among you, he must be the last. He must be the least. How many times does Jesus teach humility and laying yourself down and putting others up first? When Jesus was asked, what was the greatest commandment in all of Scripture? Jesus asserted that it was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And he said, and second is to love your neighbor as yourself. In that same passage, he tells a parable of the Good Samaritan, which basically teaches the crowd that who is your neighbor means your neighbor is anyone you come in contact with. And just from taking that passage alone, we would say Jesus says that it is our priority as we follow him to put God first and then to put everyone else before ourselves. Therefore, selfishness in its very nature goes against the will of God for our lives. That's the second truth. Number one, selfishness is a sin. Okay. Number two, just backwards it. Sin is selfishness. Sin is selfishness. What I mean by that is this. When you commit an act of selfish ambition, when you put yourself before someone else, not only is that a sin before God, but if you look at the nature of sin itself, you'll see that sin in itself is a selfish act. Let's look at Romans 6, verses 11 through 14. "In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you would obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace." In this passage, Paul says, if the opposite of sin is righteousness, and seeking righteousness means then to take on God, to basically commit ourselves, give our bodies to God, give everything that we are to God, and let him be our master, then sin, the act of choosing sin and the selfish flesh, would basically be choosing to glorify ourselves rather than to glorify God. What is the opposite of righteousness? Righteousness being the path that God wants us to walk down. Well, the opposite is sin. Another way to look at it, the opposite is selfishness. If you're not serving God with your life, Paul says that you're serving yourself. You're elevating yourself. You're using the parts of your own body for sin. Look at the passage that we looked at in Galatians chapter 5 just a few minutes ago. And let's look at the entire passage this time. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 24. Look at what Paul says to the church. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Verse 19, the acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, this is what we read earlier. Impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, faction, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. And here comes your scripture that you read for communion this morning. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, it says forbearance here, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. And notice how he closes this in verse 24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Paul says there's two ways, basically. To live in the flesh or to live by the Spirit. If living in righteousness is living in the Spirit of God, led by the Spirit of God, then living in flesh, living in sin, is basically taking and keeping control of your life in a way that would gratify your sinful flesh and your selfish desires. And so when you think of selfishness, I want you today to take a more serious, I want the church today to take a more serious approach to the idea of selfishness in culture and selfishness in our lives. Because you know what? You know, I step in front of somebody in line. I take more time for myself than I do for somebody else. I think, big deal, that's just what people do. But when you look at what sin is in essence choosing what you would do above what God would do. Sin is, in essence, selfishness. Because righteousness is at its very heart selflessness. Dying to self so that you can live for Christ. Jesus said, if anybody would come after me, truly he would deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. And so if the opposite very clearly of following God is selfishness, then selfishness and sin go hand in hand. By the way, we'll move on from this in a minute, but do you want a clear point of application? Do you want a moment where we can just stop and say, okay, if that's the problem in my life, then what can I do about it? Guys, this one's not hard. What's the opposite of living selfishly? Living selflessly. Doing things that are clearly not for you. I shouldn't have to make application here because the opposite of doing things for you is doing things for others and doing things that won't benefit you in the slightest. Husbands, you want a surefire way of making your marriage better no matter where it's at? Do something selfless every day for your wife. That's just one example. Look in your lives this week and ask yourselves, how many areas of my life are controlled by what I want to do for me? Look at your driving. Do you get super ticked off when that guy cuts you off on the parkway, but when you need to get in, you have no problem cutting somebody else off? Guys, this, and what do you think? That's just what people do. That's just driving to work on Monday morning. Don't think that as sin and selfishness bleeds into the world, that it's not also bleeding into the church. Sin in its very core is selfishness. In fact, think about the very first sin. Think about the very first sin in the Garden of Eden that Adam and Eve committed. Genesis 3, verses 2 through 6. The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from all the trees in the garden." But God did say, "You must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." Serpent says, "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and she ate it, and she gave some also to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. How did the first sin come about? Because Satan convinced man that he should be equal to God. Where did sin start? Because Satan convinced Adam and Eve that they should be like God, knowing both good and evil. And in that selfish ambition, Adam and Eve said, "You know what? That would feel pretty good if we could know what God knew. That would make us feel pretty good if we could gain wisdom." Giving no mind to the fact that God had given them a command. God had given them everything they saw. God had formed their very lives from the dust. Selfishness separated man from God in the first place. And church, it's still separating us from God today. So now let me rephrase the question as we get ready to move on. Let me rephrase the question we've been asking today. Can the unstoppable movement of God be stopped by the selfishness and the sin of those inside the church? I believe you know the answer, but to answer that question fully, let's look at the next part of this chapter. Chapter 5, this time we'll start with verse 11, we'll go through verse 16. This again is following the deaths of Ananias and Sapphira after their encounters with Peter. It says, "Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events. The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared join them, even though they were highly regarded among the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. As a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed." We have here the impact of the Ananias and Sapphira event. Verse 11 says, "The great fear came upon all those," or upon the church, "and all who had heard these things." Verse 13 says that none of the rest of them, those not meeting in Solomon's colonnade with the believers, none of the rest of them dared to join them. And yet, verse 14 says that believers continued to be added to their number, and verses 15 and 16 state that great signs and wonders continued to be performed at the hands of the apostles. Did Ananias and Sapphira's sin and their punishment lead to fear and lead to other consequences among the church and among those outside the church? Yeah, sure it did. But did that punishment and did that fear stop the work of the Holy Spirit that he was doing through the church? No way. Throughout the rest of the book of Acts, the church will continue to be the unstoppable movement of God. If you haven't figured it out already, it will soon be clear in the book of Acts that the unstoppable movement of God will not be stopped. In fact, if the answer was yes, sin can stop the unstoppable movement of God, we would call this sermon something else other than unstoppable. No. the church of Jesus Christ will not be stopped. Let's go on, and as we do, you'll find another example. Acts chapter 5, 17 through 24. This is the very next passage. Then the high priest and all of his associates, who were members of the party of the Sadducees, were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles and put them in the public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. Go stand in the temple courts, he said, and tell all the people about this new life. At daybreak, they entered the temple courts as they had been told and began to teach the people. When the high priest and his associates arrived, they called together the Sanhedrin, the full assembly of the elders of Israel, and sent to the jail for the apostles. But on arriving at the jail, the officers did not find them there. So they went back and reported. We found the jail securely locked with the guards standing at the doors, but when we opened them, we found no one inside. On hearing this report, the captain of the temple guard and the chief priests were at a loss, wondering what this might lead to. See, in this case, the religious leaders who arrested the apostles were unable even to arrest them. You want an example of the unstoppable movement of God? They put its leaders in jail for preaching, and the angel of the Lord says, get on out of here and start preaching. These are the next two lines in your bulletin, and these are the heart of today's message. Our sin cannot stop the unstoppable movement of God. Let me say it again. Our sin cannot stop the unstoppable movement of God. But the next line will tell you what it can do. But it can reveal the true church. But our sin can reveal the true church. I'll tell you what I mean. Let's look at another passage of Scripture. Acts chapter 5, this time verses 25 through 29. Then someone came and said, look, the men you put in jail are standing in the temple courts teaching the people. At that, the captain went with his officers and brought the apostles. They did not use force because they feared that the people would stone them. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, he said, and yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. Peter and the other apostles replied, and this is going to sound familiar to last week's scene as well. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than man. We must obey God rather than man. You see, in this response here to the Sanhedrin, Peter and the other apostles, we find basically the very opposite of the selfishness that drove Ananias and Sapphira to commit their sin. Think about it for a moment. Ananias and Sapphira were so concerned with what would most benefit them personally, what would most benefit them selfishly, that they justified lying to the Holy Spirit. And then on the other side are Peter and the other apostles who are so led by the Holy Spirit that they were no longer concerned with their own welfare. They could not stop preaching in the name of Jesus, even though this was the second time apostles had been arrested because of that preaching. Even though it eventually meant the ends of their lives. Even though the gospel of Jesus eventually took the lives of all 12 of these early church apostles, they were so led by the Spirit that their lives didn't gratify their selfishness at all. You see, And the question that I'm left asking is this. If that is the story of the early church, if that is the story of the book of Acts, that 12 men filled so much with the Spirit of God began a movement that could not be stopped. Why? Because they valued the movement of God, the Spirit of God, the gospel of Jesus more than their lives. And I'm left looking at the church today and thinking, if that's where it started, if the church of Jesus Christ started with 12 completely selfless men, then how did it end up with what we've got today? How did we get from there to here, where there's so much divisiveness and bickering and hatred and animosity and so much selfishness and so much sin? And how did the church go from the example of those men to here? The church wasn't without sin in those days. Ananias and Sapphira is clear proof of that. You see, the true church of Jesus Christ cannot and will not be stopped. But here's another question. Does that mean then that all who claim to be a part of the true church of Jesus Christ are part of the true church of Jesus Christ? Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does what? Who does the will of my Father who is in heaven." And so let me ask you this. Just because you and I claim to be a part of the church, does that mean we're living in step with the Spirit of God? Answer it. Does that mean just because I say, you say you're part of the church, that you're living by the Spirit of God? No. Does that mean you're doing the will of the Father just because I say I go to Nineveh Christian Church? No. No. You see, the church of Jesus Christ cannot and will not be stopped. Not today, not ever. Jesus says the gates of hell will not stand against it. But the sin within the church will reveal who is the true church and the true movement of God, and who's just along for the ride like Ananias and Sapphira were. You see, the true church will not be stopped. The question is, are you a part of the true church? We close today with one last passage, and I got to tell you, it's my favorite in chapter 5, maybe one of my favorites in the book of Acts. We close today with a speech by a man named Gamaliel in the end of Acts chapter 5. All of this has happened. You've seen it in two chapters. The apostles are eventually arrested for their faith and for their preaching. They don't know what to do with them. Two separate events. They don't know what they're going to do with these guys who just won't shut up about this name of Jesus. And finally, something happens in chapter 5, verses 33 through 39. We'll close with this passage today. "When they," the Sanhedrin, "heard this," the words of Peter, "they were furious and wanted to put them to death. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, who was honored by all of the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that these men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed the Sanhedrin." Church, listen to these words today. "Men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. Some time ago, Theudas appeared, claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied to him. He was killed, and all of his followers were dispersed, and it came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people into revolt. He too was killed, and all of his followers were scattered. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone. Let them go, for if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if It is from God. You will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God. You see, Gamaliel, and we're not told that Gamaliel ever became a believer. Gamaliel was a Pharisee. Gamaliel was a Jewish religious teacher. And Gamaliel knew the truth was this. We've killed leaders before who tried to start up rebellions. Well, we killed Jesus, who was the leader of this rebellion. And so he says, use your heads. If this is just of men, this is not going to last. We're not going to be bothered by these men much longer. But as he said these words, the next words, whether he knew it or not, he was predicting what would be the case for the rest of the life of the church. He says, but if this is of God, you guys aren't going to be able to stop it. If this is of God, you're foolish to think you're going to be able to stop it. Instead, what you will end up doing is fighting against God Himself. Today's last question in your bulletin, before I ask Corey to come out, is this. Is this of man, or is this of God? Corey and the band can come out at this time. And as they do, think about that question as we close today. Think about that question first among the church, locally, Nineveh Christian Church. Is this of man or is this of God? Nationally, statewide, the church as a whole, the Church of Jesus Christ everywhere that claims the name of Jesus. Is it of man or is it of God? Because you know as well as I do today that if it is of man, it's going to fail. If the Church of Jesus Christ is of man, let me convince you today of this. If this is man's work, it will fail and crumble. You know why? Because right now the world, the sinful world, is gearing up for a war against the Church of Jesus Christ. Today, the world will, if it's not already, do everything that it can to snuff out the influence of the Church of Jesus Christ. So that the church has no influence on a sinful world that doesn't want to hear the truth. And I'm telling you right now, if the church is of human origin, if the church is of man, then we might as well go home and just watch sports on TV. But if it is of God, then the world, the president, the government, the devil himself will not be able to stop it. Instead, they will find they are only fighting God. If the church is of man, it's going to fail. If it's of God, it will not be stopped. It will be the unstoppable movement of God. And I close today, and I ask you to think about now, not just the church. Think about your life. Think about your personal life as a part of the body of Christ. Not everyone who says to me, Jesus says, Lord, Lord, and claims me as Lord, will be a follower of mine. Not everybody, Ananias and Sapphira were proof that not everybody who claimed to be a part of the church was part of the work that the Spirit was doing. And so today, let's close today as we go into this time of invitation. And I want you to ask yourself this question. My life as a follower of Jesus, my life as a part of the Church of Jesus Christ, the unstoppable movement of God, is it of God? Is it led and guided 100% by God? Or is this of man? Is this of my control? Because let me tell you right now, your life is being lived in vain if it's being lived under your control. And so today, the invitation is open for us to ask this question. Is my life right now led by God or led by me? If it is of God, if this is of God, it will be part of the unstoppable movement of God. The very gates of hell will never be able to stand against it. Amen? If it is of you, you've got to repent of your sins before it's too late. If it's led by you, it's going to fold real fast. The invitation is open as we stand and as we sing.
Power, our God.
Pray with me as we close today. Father God, we know that if you are with us, Father, in our lives, in the church, in your bride, Father, that if you are leading and you are controlling your church, Father, there's nothing that will stand against the unstoppable movement of God. And Father, today, if this is of man, Father, if our lives are led by us instead, then Father, convict us of our sins. Shine your light of truth in our lives in a way that we will no longer live to gratify the sinful desires, the selfish nature of the flesh. But the Father, we will be a part of your true church, is living to gratify other people, living to gratify the church through the Spirit of God. Father, make us your true church today, for your true church will not be stopped. It is the unstoppable movement of God. Send us today out into the world as the unstoppable movement of God. We pray in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. God bless. Have a great day.